morning. It is so good to see you all. This has been a long time coming, yes? Well, we have a few announcements today. First of all, thank you to Kim Richardson for beautiful flowers. They look just lovely up here. So we're grateful for that gift. And also, thank you for our musicians sharing our vocalists this morning. Kim Schneider's here. A fun little story about that is that Kim and I knew each other, I don't know, at least 10 years ago, when Kim was a youth and I was doing youth ministry. And so it is a nice surprise to see her here this morning. And we're grateful for your gift of music, as well as Dave's music this morning as well. A few announcements as we continue, actually quite a few announcements. Probably next Sunday, we have an installation. I'm excited to be installed here at the neighborhood as your pastor. I'm grateful for that. And I have heard that it is going to be hot outside. So most likely, we'll keep an eye on the weather, but most likely we will be inside for next week, just as you know, as we watch the weather. It's going to be warm. And also, I wanted to invite you, too, as we are starting to come back to worship, and as we are engaging in community, I wanted to invite you to share your gifts and talents. If you'd like to help out with reading for worship, or if you would like to do other things like ushering, just involve yourself in church. We're starting to open up, and this is an exciting time, and I just welcome you to talk to me, talk to Joan in the office, different ways to be able to get involved. I would like to invite Deb to come up with, share a few things this morning. Thank you, Deb.
COVID can be really sneaky. You can have it and have no symptoms whatsoever, but you can still spread it to other people, even though you are not sick. And the unfortunate reality is the huge majority of us here are at a higher than average risk of dying from COVID. Those of us who are 65 and older are at high risk just because we're older. And many of us have what are called comorbidities, things like asthma, high blood pressure, diabetes, heart issues, that makes us even more vulnerable because all those factors get added together. And in addition to those in our own congregation who aren't vaccinated, we remember the variety of other groups who use our facility, and we have no knowledge about their vaccination status. But being here, back together in our sanctuary, just feels so right. We want to be together, we want to sing, we want to hug each other, just like we did before this pandemic knocked the whole world out of whack. And I think we can sing safely indoors if we're all masked, because remember, it's that 12-foot to manage that is to ask the person you want to hug if they're okay with a hug. If they aren't, and you know, some of us will be and some of us won't be. And remember, if someone you offer a hug to prefers not to be hugged, it's not because they don't like you. It's nothing about you. They themselves are not comfortable for whatever reason. Shaking hands is another way to share the peace. Fist bumps, elbow bumps, whatever's comfortable for you. And remember, this won't be forever. It won't be forever. The world will turn again and we'll come back to, it might be a new reality, but it will be a good reality. Thank you. Are there any questions? Thanks.
Thank you, John. And with that, let us share peace. The peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
God, our provider, help us.
It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways and they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We
Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life. Amen. Reading from Psalm 130. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplication. If you were to keep watch over sins, O Lord, who could stand? Yet you is forgiveness,
in order that you may be feared.
I wait for you, O Lord. My soul waits. In your word is my hope.
My soul waits for the Lord more than those who have kept watch in the morning.
O Israel, wait for the Lord. For with the Lord there is steadfast love. With the Lord there is plenteous redemption.
For the Lord shall redeem Israel from all their sins.
This morning our reading is from Ezra. We're in chapters 1 and 3. which is a little different from our New Testament reading, and in that it's Old Testament, we're hearing a lot of the language of captivity and exile. In the first year of King Cyrus of Persia, in order to fulfill the word of the Lord spoken to Jeremiah, the Lord turned the heart of King Cyrus of Persia to make a proclamation throughout his realm and also to put it into writing. This is what King Cyrus of Persia says: "The Lord, the God of heaven, has given me all the kingdoms of the earth, and he has appointed me to build a temple for him at Jerusalem in Judea. Any of his people among you may go to Jerusalem in Judea and build the temple of the Lord, the God of Israel, the God who is in Jerusalem, and may their God be with them. And in any of that locality where survivors may now be living, the people are to provide them with silver and gold, with goods and livestock, and with freewill offerings for the temple, or for the God of Jerusalem. When the seventh month came and the Israelites had settled in their towns, the people heard what King Cyrus of Persia had said and assembled together as one in Jerusalem. Then Joshua of Jozadak and fellow priests of Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, and his associates began to build the altar of the God of Israel to sacrifice burnt offerings on it in accordance with what is written in the law of Moses, the man of God. Despite their fear of the people around them, they built the altar on its foundation and sacrificed burnt offerings on it to the Lord, both the morning and the evening sacrifices. Then, in accordance to what is written, they celebrated the Festival of Tabernacles with the required number of burnt offerings prescribed for each day. When the builders laid the foundation of the temple of the Lord, the priests in their vestments with trumpets and the Levites with cymbals took their places to praise the Lord as prescribed by King David of Israel. With praise and thanksgiving, they sang to the Lord, 'He is good. His love towards Israel endures forever.' And all the people gave a great shout of praise to the Lord, because the foundations of the house of the Lord was laid. But many of the older priests and the Levites and the heads of families who had seen the former temple wept aloud when they saw the foundation of the temple being laid, while many shouted for joy. No one could distinguish the sounds of the shouts of joy from the sounds of weeping, because the people made so much noise, and the sound was heard from very far away." Here ends our reading.
As Kim gets set up here, it's a total coincidence that Tammy and Kim knew each other. We learned that this morning. What Tammy did mention, however, is that Kim is my niece on my wife's side, and she has performed here before when we were online. And I think we're the only active musicians in our family, so it's kind of nice that we can kind of team up for you like this. So, anyways, Kim has a journalist degree, and she does coffee shops, and she has a real unique style that I think you really enjoy.
What an introduction. Wow.
I had as made.
when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and see the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come, shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee.
Grace and peace to you, my brothers and sisters in Christ. It is so wonderful to be here today with one another, to see each other in worship. It has been a long time coming. I want you to take a moment, just take this time, and look at each other. Just look, turn around, it's okay. Turn around and look at each other. Wave to each other. Give each other a virtual hug. We are really good at sharing the peace, I've realized, and that is beautiful. That is really beautiful. We give thanks for this time together. We give thanks to God for God's steadfast love. And as we entered into this narrative story this morning, it's important to take a moment or two to recap what has happened. The exile has come to an end. However, there's still many political tensions that exist. And as the people wait to return to their land, as God had promised them, they begin to grow impatient, wondering, why has God not fulfilled God's promises? All the while, it is God who has never left them. It is God who has been steadfast in love and faithfulness to the people. And as King Cyrus of Persia conquers Babylon, it is then when things begin to change for the Israelite people. This was in fulfillment of the prophecy that was made nearly 70 years earlier by the prophet Jeremiah, that God would stay faithful to the people, and that they would return back to the land. It is now King Cyrus of Persia who the Lord stirs up in his spirit and who fulfills Jeremiah's prophecy. He orders all those who have been exiled from Jerusalem to return to their land and to live a normal life. It is a dream that many refugees can only dream about. To return home, to return to the life that they once once had that they knew. But how can people really do that when so much has happened? Much of their land has changed. The temple has been destroyed. And yet it is King Cyrus who says to them, go live a normal life, rebuild the temple, practice your religion, and may God be with you. It's a bittersweet time for the people, one that is filled with both shouts of joy and loud weeping of lament. And as they return to their land and to the temple, there are some who are shouting for joy just at the sight of the temple. And yet, it is some of the older folks who've been away for some 50 to 60 years who see the temple and begin to weep. Not only is the return difficult for some of them, but how they remember the temple to be is different from the one that they once knew. Yes, the square footage is about the same, it's pretty similar, but the overall blueprint of the temple has changed. Some scholars say that the temple was not nearly as ornate as it once was, the very first one, and that the overall architecture was different. And some believe that the temple was not nearly as great as the first one. The change moved them to tears, so loud that they could not be distinguished from the shouts of joy. There's tension that exists between being joyful, returning to a homeland, and seeing that things have changed and are different from what you once remember. In many ways, it's a story that we might relate to today. While we have been waiting a long time to return to church and to be in worship here in the sanctuary, this beautiful sanctuary, to worship God together, we have long-standing traditions and expectations of how worship should be and what is important to each one of us, as well as the group collectively. We have been missing our friends over this last year and a half, and we've had friends who have passed away that we've not been able to grieve. We've not been able to grieve that loss together, and we are feeling that loss. Many of you have told me that being in the sanctuary means a lot to you, that you are missing sitting in the pews, missing singing hymns, missing sharing peace, and missing having quiet reflection in this space, this sacred space. And you are missing communion, not communion in the little packets that we have, but communion where we come up and we receive communion. And that's hard. All of that is hard. And so here we are today. We are gathered and we are still missing some of our friends. There are some friends who choose not to join us today because of their own comfort levels. And we respect that. We are also grieving the people who are not here because maybe they can't be here for one reason or another. We are missing them as well. We are not all on the same page with how comfortable we are in returning to worship, and that is okay. It's important that we acknowledge that and we respect one another. We respect each other's feelings. And while I say that I am grateful that we are here together today, I also want us to hold space for how we are feeling, for how everyone is feeling, whether they're present or not present here today. for these months being away from this place that we call home has been hard and it has been exhausting. And we need to acknowledge that. We need to acknowledge that we are now returning to worship inside, and that is both joyful and it is hard. We struggle as human beings when things are different from how we remember them to be, when our traditions, our experiences change or they fall short from our expectations. We can't help but to feel sad, disappointed, or even tearful. And maybe that's how you are feeling this morning. Or maybe you have a mixture of the joy and the sorrow. It's important that we name the laments in our lives, because culturally we don't do this very well. We tend to stay in the joy part of our lives, forgetting or brushing off the darkness. Times when we are waiting for glimmers of hope. And yes, it is the joy that is important too. And I'm not suggesting for a moment that we not be joyful, because it is important. But I am suggesting that we be present, that we be present to this tension of the joy and the weeping, because that's what's important too, to acknowledge our own sadness and be aware of the sadness that others may be feeling in this new season of life. It's important that we support one another and grieve in difficult times when we feel that all hope is lost. And in 2 weeks, we'll be gathering again inside for a healing service. And I hope that you will be able to join us. We'll come together and worship, to share our griefs, and to lean into the presence of God for support. Support and love, the love that we need, the faithfulness that God gives to each of us. And in the midst of our shouts of joy and our weeping, it is God who is present with us. That God is dwelling with us. And in our weeping, God too weeps alongside with each of us. During these months of pandemic, we have seen the faithfulness and the steadfast love of God in our own lives in a variety of ways. And it is the presence of God that we find hope. Hope not only for ourselves, but hope for the world that is very much in need of healing and restoration, and in the lives of others who are also searching for hope, God is present. God is still loving us, and God is still abiding with us, and it is Jesus who enters into this world so that we might have the courage, the hope, and the comfort in the midst of darkness, so that we may remember that the people that we have lost and the changes that now exist, that God is present in those lamentations. And it is in this presence of Christ, the one who was born in a manger, a little baby, who died on the cross, that we find hope, that we are filled with hope. And that has the power to change the world and to illuminate the darkness in our lives. And that is life-giving. God loves you, and so do I.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Let us come before the triune God in prayer. God of wholeness, we pray for believers all over the globe. Unify us in service of the gospel, that we may work together as beloved siblings to share your love with all. Lord, in your mercy. God of the cosmos, we pray for creation, the gardens, the waterways, the creatures near to us, the diverse forms of life that remain unseen. Teach us to treat the natural world with reverence, seeking restoration when human divisions have caused harm to your beloved creation. Lord, in your mercy. God of all people, we pray for harmony among nations. Cast out from us clean spirits of greed and fear, that we may work in solidarity with one another for the common good. Lord, in your mercy. God of abundance, we pray for those who are oppressed or in any need. Encourage those who have begun to lose heart. Strengthen and renew us with your Spirit. Lord, in your mercy. God of the ages, in your goodness, you have sent us faithful witnesses for every time and place. We give you thanks for those saints who now rest in eternal mercy. Lord, in your mercy. We know the saints we love near and far are also in need of your blessing. So we lift them up by name and ask you to reach and touch your tender, loving hands on Jerry, Juliana, Maida, Phyllis, Ruth, Kay, Shirley, Piper, Katie, Patty, Matthew, Betty, Rita, Helen Grace, John and Virginia, Dave, Karen, Helen, Tom, Ryan, Betty, Beth. Lord, we lift up any other prayers that come to our mind that we sacrifice to speak to you. We lift up all these prayers of God, trusting in your abiding grace. Amen. I invite you to stand as you are able. Let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, you so loved the world that you gave your only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. We give you thanks for his coming into this world to fulfill for us your holy will, and to accomplish all things for our salvation. Amen. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant of my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." We join our voices together with the Lord, with the Lord's Prayer, the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us for our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You are invited to unwrap your communion packages, and you're invited to sit down, and Dave is going to play some more music for us to enjoy. Christ has set the table with more than enough. Come and eat and be satisfied.
My heart want to sing.
stand if you're able. Let's pray. Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask for. As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with our own life. In your name we pray. Amen. Receive the blessing. The blessing of God who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us, be upon you now and forever. Amen. Go in peace. You are the body of Christ. Thanks be to God.